So I was wondering, what is it that's holding me back? I don't think there's very much, really. And I'm just getting ready to tape here. And someone comes up along the path and says, "Oh, hello, I'm with a nonprofit and I'd like to speak with you." And I said, "I'm busy, I'm dealing with stuff." And he says, "Oh, it'll only take a minute." I said, "Well, I'm really focused on something right now and I don't want to break my focus, so maybe you can come back later." And it really threw him off track. It's like, wow, I've never said anything like that in my life. I've always solicited if somebody says, "Well, just only take a minute," I'll say, "Oh, okay," and I'll defer. I'll defer. Now, this time, first time in my life, I said, "No, I'm too focused, and you're gonna have to come back later. I'm right in the middle of something." Amazing. Never done that before. So that may be exactly what is holding me back, is something I'm allowing something to postpone. Say, "Well, it only take a minute." Well, how long does a minute take compared to right now? How long does time take, for instance? Time is not right now, is it? It's always a minute. If it's not now, it's time. So that was very, very, very interesting situation that just happened. I can tell you, what would it be like to have been in my shoes the last 2 days? It would be absolutely intense beyond any description. It's been most 2 intense days of my life. Today has just been the most drastic day imaginable. Surprise is coming right and left, and just tumultuous, collapsing, credible things are just horrific and shocking and amazing and startling and just like, wow. And the insights have been so over the top, insights that are so devastating that I don't even think I can even share them here because they're so, they indict the whole, all of existence is so indicted by seeing this and seeing what the opposition really is all about. It's truly terrible. Beyond anything that I had quite put together, and it started happening yesterday. Whew, and I've just been hanging in there. I didn't think I was going to make it through yesterday. I didn't think I was going to be alive today, really. It was so intense and so scary. And then today it just doubled up, completely doubled up. So still here, but under siege, to say the least. At least it appears that way. I'm holding my own, though. It's amazing. This world is based on death. I'll tell you that. It is based on death. The most cherished value of the world is death. Without death, there wouldn't be any world. There'd be no purpose for it. The whole purpose of this world is to make death real. That's the entire purpose of this world. It's a hypothetical scenario with the intent to make death real. Okay? Because only but how can we survive the annihilation of reality if we're not surviving the death of something real? So existence is symbolic, it's hypothetical, but we say it's useless if it's only hypothetical. So we say there's a miracle of God is to make death real for us, and then by making death real, and then we can then survive it or overcome it through rebirth, and then that will save us. That's our salvation, which is totally insane teaching, completely insane teaching. And what I found out was that I've been targeted because the claim from existence is that I'm somehow poisoning Jesus's mind, trying to change his mind. See, existence believes that Jesus is bestowing death upon existence, that his death bestowed death upon existence, made death real, and then the resurrection showed the survival of death. But death is real, but we survive it. And that then gives us the salvation of finding a contingency plan to survive the annihilation of reality so we can become prime creator. And I see very clearly that's not true at all. Bogus. And Jesus also knows it's totally bogus and has taught me that that's incorrect. So the world thinks I'm trying to change Jesus's mind and poison his mind against death and get him to stop making death real, or say that death isn't real, and so it wants to get rid of me, and it's totally crazy because It's Jesus who taught me all this, that death is not real, and everything I know I was taught through the grace of God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ, my spiritual mentors, have taught me this. So it's the religion of the world that is mistaken. And they wrongly think that somehow, because I'm so adamant about this, they say, oh, he's trying to change Jesus' mind or something. No, I'm just trying to agree with Jesus, is all. So because of this, on the subtle levels, things have gotten very tumultuous with me. Because I'm able to see through the situation so clearly now that existence is alarmed. Very alarmed that I might change Jesus' mind, because it seems I'm so clear about it and so adamant. They say, oh my gosh, they're all, it's very scary on the subtle levels. But the subtle levels are now playing out with tumultuous stuff going on. God's plan of salvation is very simple. Is to exchange this hypothetical for another one, which is everything appears supremely, flawlessly, unchangingly beautiful and exquisite, reflecting the nature of reality. We don't want to change anything, which is the attitude we have to have in reality. We don't want to change anything, because nothing's changeable. It's impossible. But the issue of making death real is so crucial, so crucial, so crucial. It came upon me when I was in church and I heard the homily talking about, they said that at a Jewish wedding, they were running out of wine, and Jesus' mother Mary realized this and realized this was a disaster. You can't run out of wine at a Jewish wedding. So she decided to ask Jesus to somehow do a miracle and give more wine. And even though Jesus said, it's not my time yet. But then they said that Jesus is incapable of saying no to his mother. So any request you want to make of Jesus that you don't think he'll fulfill, if you put this to his mother, he has to fulfill it. In other words, he's an intercessor. But it immediately came to my mind. I said, well, wait a minute. Whoa, 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 whoa. What if we wanted Jesus to kill us? Okay, to murder us, and he wouldn't do it. Does that mean that we go to his mother and say, please get Jesus to murder us, and then he will do it? That was like, I said, well, no, wait a minute. This teaching is not right. That's a very dangerous teaching. And then from that point, I said, holy cow. And I was leaving the church, and I suddenly heard this voice say, murder me, Jesus. Like a prayer, like, please, murder me, Jesus. It was like an internal thing. I heard this, and it wasn't anyone saying it. It was something I somehow subtly picked up a vibe of what's going on. I said, what in the world? What is that? And then today, I put it together. I see that the people of the world are really pleading for death. They're pleading for death to be real. Think that making death real is salvation. And that's completely opposite and backwards of what Jesus teaches. And they think that by having an intercessor with Jesus, by praying to an intercessor, that they can convince Jesus to make death real for us, that he doesn't want to, but he cannot resist his mother asking him to do something. Why is his mother God? Does his mother know what is best for us more than he does? More than God? How's that possible? Jesus doesn't know what's best for us and needs to be, have someone else tell him? Is that really true? It's not true. So my mind caught that, and I just said, hey, wait a minute, there's a real problem there. You can't have an intercessor forcing Jesus to do something which is totally insane. That's just not possible. And he wouldn't do that. He absolutely wouldn't do that. It's just nonsense. So, let us click on this because it's, okay, it's getting buggy. Very buggy. This morning I did taping and two uploads to YouTube were aborted. First time ever that the actual upload was aborted twice. So it's just been an unbelievable day. So, very intense insights and suddenly seeing through, my gosh, stuff you have to have nerves of steel to be able to see this. You have to be very, very calm and composed because I realize, holy cow, the world wrongly thinks that I'm somehow that I'm some super dangerous person out to destroy salvation or something, which is nonsense. I'm someone who is here to clarify what salvation really is, according to the mission that Jesus has for the world, which is to explain what salvation really is. And of course, he said people would hate you for it. absolutely hate you for it. And but the depth of it is shocking. So I don't know. Everything's up in the air right now, really. I certainly see the dynamics, and yet nothing is, no answer to my prayers have occurred yet, as far as how I could be helped. But the idea of taking some time out of this very important taping to listen to some speech about some nonprofit, which they're canvassing the area right now, I said, no, no way, no, this is more important. So I put this first. I put this primary. You see, helping the world. Here's another issue that I realized yesterday is absolutely stunning and very true, is that I put this in a video yesterday. It is that it makes no difference what's taking place in the world. Absolutely no difference. The stage is so beautiful, becomes so beautiful in the vision of Christ. It doesn't matter what song the band is playing. It makes no difference. It can be playing a heavy metal death song, can play a light, beautiful, you know, sonata, an opera, an aria, whatever. It doesn't make any difference. So it doesn't make any difference what's taking place in the world. It doesn't matter if the times are bad, super bad, really heavy, atrocious, so-so, kind of nice, good. No difference whatsoever. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. So we don't have to put our attention on what's taking place in the world at all for God's plan of salvation to work, because we're only looking at the staging, not the play. Play is irrelevant. It's useless. Has no utility to it whatsoever. None. So there's no need to judge what's taking place. We don't even need to be aware of it. It doesn't matter. Which is why some of those great teachers, they seem to be oblivious to what's taking place in the world, not even paying any attention. If someone insists that they do, they can look, notice it, and say, yeah, but doesn't matter. Everything, it makes no difference to what I see. Everything is perfect. So we have that going. We have a lot going for us right now. It is a momentous time like nothing we've ever seen, actually. And the world came down super heavy on me. Has coming down very heavy on me. It's unbelievable what's taking place, really. I can't get into all of it. The pressure is being brought to bear because see, the world believes that death is salvation, that making death real is salvation. They really believe that. It's an insane belief because it can never happen. Hypotheticals can't be real. And death is a hypothetical. God did not make death. There's no death in reality. It's totally hypothetical. You can't make a hypothetical real. So I don't know how I can possibly explain the situation any clearer. So I don't know what I'm waiting for, really. What the holdup is, the hang-up is, because this is, it's clear as a bell, it's simple, it's obvious, it's basic. Hypotheticals can never be real. Even the hypothetical of the blessed world is not real. Hypothetical of the overlay, perfect, equal, unconditional love on everything, it's not real. The happy hypothetical is not real. The beautiful, exquisite, enlightened world of filled with, bathed in this beautiful light, that's not real. It's hypothetical still. It's just as unreal as this dark, hellish nightmare here of trying to make death real. That's also completely unreal. Both are completely unreal. The only question is utility, which is useful. That's the only question there is. There is no other question whatsoever. You just say, is this useful? Is this truly useful? Two, what's the only purpose could be? To remember reality. To get a very clear continuity issue. How do we remember reality? How do we get that continuity, feeling a continuity back to reality, dropping hypotheticals altogether? That's it. That's the entire plan. There is no other plan. It's very simple. Jesus' plan is very simple. Trying to make death real is very complicated and impossible. And it's involved all sorts of magical, twisted, distorted stuff. My gosh. I was so shocked when I heard that, murder me, Jesus. What? I said, what? That's not what I want. I said, that's nuts. That's not what I want. Why did that arise? It came from the prayers of the congregation. That they want death to be real. They want to make death real and then overcome it. It's exactly what this hypothetical is all about. It's how a contingency plan, how to survive the annihilation of reality, the real. It's how to, when the real is killed, is dead, is annihilated, how do you then survive it through, quote-unquote, the resurrection? Somehow you're resurrected and there's something that survives the annihilation of reality. That's a completely magical delusion. And I can't believe for a second that Jesus actually played a part in that, not based on the teachings that he's clarified perfectly clear to me. There's some distortion that has crept in there. Very much so. So, I was able to, you know, vet the entire situation. But of course, it's ruffled some major feathers. And the higher-ups of this false plan of making death real. So, I've been just going through all of this and trying to sort it out, but things are still very chaotic in my life, I'll tell you that. Yesterday, wow, I felt that I'd reached the end. I could not go any further. It was really, that's it. And yet today, bounce back day, and yet it was still just absolutely wild. So, so there's definitely, everything is suddenly boom. Just as I said, the chord has been struck. Really. It's full on right now. It is full on. I realize it's very targeted suddenly. I mean, it's just like, wow. I reject that. I reject that tardy. I reject the whole notion of it. I reject the idea that somehow I'm interfering with any plan of salvation. That's nonsense. Just the opposite. And holding out vision of Christ to everyone equally. Everyone's equally entitled to it. Nobody's more entitled to it than anyone else. And all the false cases the ego has given to try and trick us at this time, I reject all those notions. God didn't create one aspect of spirit greater than the other aspects. There isn't some guru superior, eternally superior to everyone else. That is absolute nonsense. Total nonsense. So, and it's total arrogance to think that we can change what Christ created us as. Total arrogance to think we're bodies. We're in this world of death, etc. Utter arrogance. So Jesus tells us, lay down that arrogance and accept what you really are, which is perfection. That's not arrogance. How is it arrogant to accept what God created you as? How is that? What is that arrogant to? It's not to God. It's arrogant to insist that you can change what God created. You can deny and say, no, I'm not that. I'm something else. That's trying to be arrogant to God. But God is not upset about that at all. Just saying, it's amusing saying, hey, no, you can't change what you are. Don't worry, there's no annihilation of reality. It can never take place. You don't need to try to make death real. Choose a hypothetical where you're not trying to make death real. Just let everything be exquisite. You're not trying to make any part of a hypothetical real. And therefore, everything can appear equally beautiful, you see. There's no death anywhere. There's no motive to try and make something real so you can see it's all unreal, but it's beautiful. You'll see this is all unreal, but it's bathed in this exquisite light, this beautiful light. So, I don't know how my days are going to go. Today was so disruptive that I don't even know what to say. On all fronts, my totality of my life suddenly became tremendously disrupted. Unexpectedly, really, wow. Just like, hey, this is what's going on here, I tell you. So, as expected, I said that today, Blue Monday, the most depressing day of the year, it's going to be the most intense day that many of us have ever faced. Last couple days, actually, Sunday and Monday, and it turned out to be exactly true. And I said it's going to be full on now, so I inaugurated the Global Challenge. Global Challenge is to be able to see what salvation really is, what the true plan of salvation really is. I can rework the wording of it if necessary. I said, be the best that we can be, which is be as clear as we can possibly be about what the true plan of salvation really is. It has nothing to do with making death real. It has to do with dropping that hypothetical. Stop demanding we make death real. Because no matter how many times we die, it doesn't make it real. It remains hypothetical. It's a waste of time. All our dying is a waste of time. Total waste of time. And yet somehow I'm being seen as the bad guy because I'm showing you where freedom is. See, that's the craziness of this world. Is they think I'm somehow leading people astray away from salvation. It's just the opposite. So I really don't know how it's going to go. From minute to minute right now at this point, it's overly intense, I would say. I'm still calm, but underneath you really feel like, wow, what in the world is going on today, honestly? Because something full on today, full on. And it was just packed a punch. And I felt suddenly today, I felt so supremely targeted. And it's just like, hey, you have to be eliminated, period. I said, wow, where did that come from, really? And it's like, yeah. But I said, today is the day where it's full on now. The goddess of destructivity, in other words, that the one that's trying to make death real is now pushed the accelerator to the floor. Shifted gears, and this is it. This is it. The acceleration is on. It happened just like clockwork, just like I predicted it would. And the goddess of destructivity suddenly gave her marching orders to everybody. And who are the bad guys, who are the good guys? And I felt immediately I was targeted. I'm like one of the worst guys in that scheme of looking at things, which is a completely diluted way of looking at things. And they think that somehow Jesus is in on this, making death real. In fact, he's the key component. He's the one driving the whole thing. So if you try to, someone, I might be trying to change his mind and make him see that it's not necessary, which they say you're completely deluding him. You have delusional capability to delude him. So he might stop being the key cog in all this, and then the whole plan might fall apart. So they feel it's supremely threatening. They see me as very threatening. I'm not threatening anyone. Can't make death real. It's absolute nonsense. We don't need a contingency plan to survive the annihilation of reality. Total nonsense. You can't change reality at all. And this teaching aligns with Jesus' teaching. Absolutely. I'm positive of it. Positive of it. So, of course, I align myself with the mission of Jesus Christ, bringing the true plan of salvation here to minds who are desperately tired of all this fear and terror, trying to make death real. And I cannot accept any harm upon myself in this mission, because the people need it, even though they don't realize. It's like the insane people don't know, the insanity doesn't know what's in its best interest, really. And it's not in the best interest of anyone for me to be eliminated at all. Absolutely not. So I reject any and all notions of that in that direction entirely. And so I do accept the protection of Jesus Christ entirely. Because this mission does need to be aired out, does need to be heard. Because otherwise people just continue on with the futility of dying and dying and dying and dying and dying and dying. And how long does that go on? It just goes on as long as you continue to ignore the truth, the true plan of salvation. But it will stop when you decide, hey, there is a true plan of salvation. And it's all about not trying to make death real. Except the hypothetical, well, you're not trying to make death real. What if death couldn't be real? Then you wouldn't need to see death anywhere, would you? You would not need to see death anywhere, which means you could see the vision of a blessed world where you don't see anything, any death whatsoever. Everything seems to be in this state of bliss. Everything. And so, of course, you're blissful because you're feeling the vibe, the blissful vibe from everything. No death, no death, no death. No, absolutely not. Can't make a hypothetical real. Cannot, even Jesus can't, even God can't make a hypothetical real. It's nonsense to suggest that Jesus is trying to make a hypothetical real. If that was the case, he'd be completely insane. So then you'd have some completely insane leader of a completely insane plan. And that's ridiculous. It's not a plan of salvation. So I'm getting a lot of grief, I tell you, and I don't know how it's going to work out. But positive. But I don't really need any more troubles. So it's going to be very interesting, to say the least. The heat is on. Just as I said, heat is on. And I wonder how it's going with you. And you don't be surprised. Don't be surprised if sudden shakeups happen in your life. Sudden shakeups. Big shakeups. Colossal earthquake shakeup in your life. And because it's kind of like decision time. People are deciding, you know, do they want to try to keep making death real, or do they want to drop the demands that death has to be real? One of the two. It is one of the two. There's no third option. You either try to make death real, or you don't try to make death real. There's no third option. You see, that is what the ego stalls. It stalls for time. So there's no third option. Either you're trying to make death real, or you're not trying to make death real. That's it. There is no other place to stand on. There's no fence to sit on. There is no fence. People think they're sitting on a fence. Again, that's delusional. It's being engaging with delusion. There is no fence to sit on. That's why Jesus said, either with me or you're against me. Either for me or against me. Which means there's no fence to sit on. Either you're trying to make death real or you're not. One or the other. One or the other. So I'm just praying that some grace of the Spirit comes upon me, so I'm able to help others to a greater extent. Because right now it's just kind of conceptual. It's conceptual. It's adamant and conceptual. But I'm still like a little dorm, you know, church mouse that cannot hit their stride fully in the world, because it is what's going on. It's quite intimidating, really. Quite intimidating. You realize that you are truly feared as an extreme threat, which is the last thing I want to be, of course. And I'm not threatening truth at all. Truth is not being threatened by what I'm saying. It's being agreed with. It's those who are trying to make death real that are trying to threaten death. And I'm just saying death isn't, trying to threaten reality. Those who are trying to make death real are trying to threaten reality. And I'm saying that reality is not threatened at all. Truth is not threatened at all by this. It's not. That's the good news. That's the gospel. So I'm just spreading the gospel. That's all. That's the good news. The real good news. And this gospel must be spread. Must be heard. So how things will go with me, I ask for prayers for my well-being and for this mission that I'm doing, that I continue strong and get stronger and able to shake off the ferocious fangs that are chomping. It's really the jaws, the ferocious fangs are now about in the world looking for something to chomp. So we have now arrived at the time, and it came in with a bang. It came in with a boom. Holy cow. Again, this is the most stunning 24 hours of my life, for sure. It's been about 24 hours, actually. But, you know, still here, still clear as a bell, still very aware, more aware than ever. More adamant than ever, you know, unbowed, unbroken, unfazed, but a little bit, you know, shaky about the future. What's next? What's the next shoe to fall? Really, what's the next shoe to fall? Wow, when's the other shoe gonna fall? I don't know. Somehow you have to have faith. You have to have faith that somehow you're protected. Otherwise, you know, wow, the world is ferocious right now. The world has really become suddenly ferocious, which is what I predicted. It's on the subtle levels right now, but it's actually percolating now through to the gross levels. It'll become ferocious, very ferocious. There's going to be an intense effort to make death real right now in the world. I've been saying that my whole life, and I say it's coming. Last couple of years, I say it's coming very soon, and now recently I said it is going to start happening after January 21st. On that day, it's going to start, and that's exactly what started. Intense effort to make death real, because the world believes that's salvation. That is salvation. Everybody dies, and then somehow, there's like Phoenix-like, there will be somehow resurrection. If we just believe that death is made real, somehow that saves us. This is 100% delusional. Totally insane. This can never happen. It's meaningless. Has no purpose, no utility, no purpose whatsoever. It's just a complete waste of time. So I say these things over and over, and again, I wish I have the gift of the Holy Spirit can come upon me so that I can have somehow the ability to push this out into the world with a better stride. That I get help. Get more help, because this message is accurate. This message is on point. I'm sure of that. But again, I'm just a little shaky little church mouse who hasn't really much capacity seemingly to do much of anything, except right now do a little taping. So hopefully, you know, Pentecost was the days where the Holy Spirit gave a blessing. So anyway, that's it. Very great. Thank you.